Hi all, we're going to get started in just 10 seconds.
Okay.
Welcome to the last session of the afternoon for the J Champions Conference. Victor has asked to do his own intro, so introducing Victor Arantia.
Hi. So, all right, let's get started. The definitive guide to working with exceptions in Java. Now, that's a bold title, isn't it? First of all, I want to make it clear, I wrote a series of articles with further details on some of these topics that I will cover. Check them out here. Also, there is a Git in which you can find all the code for the session. All right, so let's go. Let's get going. I'm Victor, obviously a Java champion. But my heart is with simple design, refactoring, and unit testing. Roughly 2 years ago, I started a community in which I could share my passion for this, which has now become one of the largest communities in my country, a Ubiquitous Software Craftsmanship community with over 2,000 members. And feel free to join. We are open to English speakers also. Now, on my website, you can find the blog, a collection of my best talks and other goodies, like, for example, a shortcut cheat sheet for IntelliJ. Now, less than a year ago, I left my job from IBM. I was a lead architect there, and I left to be able to fully dedicate to trainings. And my first training was 8 years ago. Since then, thousands of developers, almost 50 companies, and more than 100 days after the outbreak. Of course, my comfort zone is the Java world, so Spring Hibernate, Advanced Functional Programming, Java 8, and Java Performance. But surprisingly, the topics which I most wanted are exactly the things which I love: design patterns, clean code, and unit testing. And I do this in all sorts of companies and teams and every day. This is what I do basically every day. Okay, so in case you are interested to join training yourself, or you want to contact me for a dedicated company training, there are my contact details. This is my website. I'm also on the social media right there. In case you want to reach me out, feel free. I'll be more than happy to talk to you afterwards. Good. Now, this session is actually one part of my clean code training. It's actually one section regarding to exception handling, how we can do this in effective ways. So let's get started with a bit of history, first of all. And I want to go back in time. At first, there were no functions. But wait, I went too far. No, not that far. At the beginning, there were no exceptions. Now, 40 years ago in C, when a function terminated in error, it would return a non-zero return code, integer that you had to check. You can imagine how easy it was for you to forget to do that. C++ tried to fix that by introducing invisible exceptions which propagate down the code stack and will terminate the program execution unless you caught them. Nice. 10 years after, Java tried to fix the problem because, you know, developers suddenly weren't aware what exceptions could be thrown by the functions they called. And Java tried to fix that 10 years after, and when Gosling introduced checked exception to force developers to realize about some particular error exceptions. Interesting. Now, you have to realize this was happening in the age of libraries. In the 90s, people were just realizing the benefits of reuse. Libraries and frameworks were being created everywhere. And back in those days, even we were creating way more user interface applications in Java or batch applications than we do today. Today, in the applications I see in dozens and dozens of companies, when handling exceptions, we do not recover. We never recover. We just die. We just terminate the use case abruptly, just terminate the flow, the request that we were handling. But still, the checked exceptions are still here with us today. How do we handle them? How do we work with them? Now, I will like to start with this code, super simple code sample, which assumes that if the order offer date is before the end of sales, you might get a discount. Otherwise, there will be no discount for you. Now, the end of sale you should take from config get last promo date. And let's call that config get last promo date. When you call this method, however, you see that it throws at you an exception. You could propagate it outwards, I mean, throw it away. But honestly, let's suppose Bill just wanted to handle this one. And how would he handle it? For example, he could just try catch. But imagine Bill wasn't really sure how should he handle this exception. So instead, he would put the to-do and go send an email to the business asking how should they handle the case in which this exception is popping. Interesting. Just imagine that several weeks after, Bill forgets the problem, of course. But several weeks after, Alan comes to Discord and wants to change his implementation of get last promo date. He is tasked to go and load the properties, this last promotion date, not from the system property, but from a properties that he loaded from disk. So let's try to do that. I will just instantiate new properties. Good. Make them. Let's see. Introduce the properties. Yes, thank you. And then this, make it a variable, and then try with resources. Very good. So we've actually loaded the properties from the disk. Unfortunately, this caused a new exception to be there somewhere. And because Alan considers it's not his job to handle this exception, he will just throws, add the exception to meta signature. So it just throws the exception out of the method. Now imagine what happens whenever he, at the moment he wants to save and push and go home, suddenly he finds that the code of Bill doesn't compile anymore, because you know this doesn't correctly handle IO exception that he now threw. So what he does in the following, he would add this exception here. But just for a second, I know that sounds insane, but imagine this code is more than 11 years old. Prior to Java 7, this would result in two catches. And because he wanted not to repeat the code, he just did that. Oh my God. And went about to ask, what should we do in that catch? And the code leaves like this, is left like that, and goes to production. And then several days, maybe a month after, everyone forgot about that problem, then you got a very weird error. When you run the code in production, you find that this business method really abruptly terminates. Looking at the code, you can see that the start is printed correctly, but then neither applying discount, neither no discount is printed. Just look at it. If you enter the if, you should either go one path or the other. How the heck nothing gets printed? Of course, I think you get it. You know why this happens. But in real world cases, it might be a very difficult task to find out who swallowed the exception, because that's what you do here. You just swallow an exception. And to make it to see the exception, you could at least do that. Let's try to run this again to see what we get. Let's see. It appears that there was a null pointer exception terminating the execution at this line, at line 20. But more than that, since I'm running on Java 15, I have this nice error message. So let's spend a minute to see how nice exception message the null pointer exception has starting Java 15. You would probably benefit from this maybe next autumn when Java 17 LTS will be out. But look how, I mean, it's obvious. The order get offered date is null. That's why you couldn't call this method. So it is precisely this dot which causes the exception, okay? Very easy to find out what's the problem. Now, you grab the phone, you ask the business, and you find out the offer date can never be null. So probably there is a data inconsistency. In my simple example, let's just assume that I fixed the data inconsistency in the database. We run the code again, and guess what? We now, let's see. We fall in another null pointer exception. But this time, it's on a different line. It's here. Look at it. It says, customer get member card is null. So customer get member card returned null. So this dot caused a null pointer exception. Without this nice message, it would be very hard to find out which of these dots really caused the exception to occur. Nice. So this dot caused the exception, and we would do for now just a very, very brute force solution to this. We will just check for null, and we will enter the if only if this is not null, okay? By hiding away from null. We will come back to that later on. But finally, we see that we get no discount because we understand, and then we fall on this branch, and we get printed all of, I mean, this started to get printed. Cool. Now let's see what happens next. The question that we are left with, what are we doing here, really? This is terrible practice. Do not ever catch exception, because as you see, you can end up catching null pointer exception. Don't ever do that. Let's revert to what was there at the beginning. This is better. But even better than that, you have to ask yourself, will this, what this really does? This will print to system error. Folks, I have a bad news for you. Most library, most frameworks out there will not capture system error in your log file. So you will not see this text trace, even if you do that. And the bad news is that that's the default. That's what your IntelliJ or your Eclipse will generate if you just, where is the package? This is the default. And the bad news is that this might not be printed in your log file. So this is not the way to handle it. The best way to handle it is to throw a runtime wrapping the checked exception, letting the runtime propagate outwards. However, one could legitimately ask, why should I, in my business logic code, be aware, know or see that the configuration throws exception? Why should I know that? Why should I know that this one throws parse exception, an IO exception? From a design point of view, this we call this an abstraction leak, because we become aware of different of this implementation detail that we are parsing data and work with files. So to work around that, we could try catch around here like that. We can add this catch to my okay. Bad code. Are we there yet? Let's see if I can manage to. Yep, let's merge them. And instead of printing this, just throw new runtime. Let's see, what did I do wrong? I think a bracket, yeah. Well, again, and once more. How many brackets, man? Good, let's see. Am I done? Try. Wait a second, something is fishy. Let me undo it just a bit. So, the simplest way to do it, really, was just to go from here, exactly from here, and grab all that and wrap within a try catch. That's the safest way. And then this is TNR. TNR, which is a large template that I've created. Very good. So this is the best way to handle it. To convert it into a runtime exception, but not in plain sight, but inside the code that you should not be leaking these exceptions out of the implementation. Let's draw some conclusions from this section. First of all, if you ever end up catching exception and doing nothing in there, okay, with the so-called swallowing exception technique, this is a famous anti-pattern named diaper anti-pattern. It tends to be for some reason it appears to be more used by people with children to represent that when you do that, you catch not only what you intended, but also you might end up catching, like we did, null pointer exceptions or bugs. It's a very dangerous technique. Never do that. Never, ever do that. But you would say, wait a second, I would never do that anyway, because the default code block generated by my editor is this. But again, the bad news is that system error might not be captured in your log file. Make sure that this is, I mean, be cautious about this. You might actually slip and miss this exception. Dangerous. So, because checked exception forces us to do try, throws, catch, and all sorts of nasty things, that's why runtime exceptions won the war. We only use runtime exceptions nowadays, right? Because they don't annoy us. We don't see them. They can just fly away without disturbing us. And even more than that, from a design point of view, it's a perfectly legitimate question to ask, why should I know that method I called would throw IO exception? Why should I care? Why should I care that it works with files? We call this an abstraction leak, and it's another reason why we should prefer only to use runtime exceptions today. So what do we do with them? We catch the checked exception, and we wrap it in a new runtime that you throw instead. Simple as that. Very simple. Now, there is an interesting discussion about what do you do with recurring exception that you really want to hide, not to pollute your log file. I won't go into more details here. I will just point you to my blog, and then only I want to highlight that it is possible to lower the log level at runtime via Spring Actuator or a GMX bin exposed by Logback without restarting. You can temporarily lower the log level to trace, for example, catch that exception and see that exception, and then put it back on info, for example, right in production. Now, you see, people that hunted for many nights for such diaper patterns, those developers, those seasoned developers, were left with what we call post-traumatic stress. And even when this became the widely accepted best practice, they would still log the exception and then throw it away. And if you ask them, they would tell you, just to be sure. This is fear, my friends. Because if you do this, that same exception will end up logged multiple times in your log file, polluting your log time, appearing multiple times, making you wonder, are there different exceptions, or what happens? Why are there three exceptions, for example? That's an anti-pattern. We name it log rethrow anti-pattern. You should not be logging before rethrowing. Instead, the real solution is to rely on a global exception handler that will correctly log and report any unhandled exceptions that slip from your core logic. And this would allow you to strip your core logic from any kind of checked exception. Inside the middle of your logic, you should not be working with checked exceptions, only runtime ones. Interesting. Now, every now and then you have to work with some library which throws at you some checked exception or some legacy code that does that. When this happens, make sure you convert these checked exceptions right at the boundaries before ever entering the middle of your logic, the core of your logic. Interesting. Now, we then have to present these errors to the users. What should you show your users? What should you show them? Well, just to make some very simple point here, I would copy this entire code from here into a Spring Boot, very trivial Spring Boot application, the simplest I could ever write. And if you run this right now, let's see what happens. Let's see what happens. So where is my... Okay, and localhost 8080, and if everything goes well, nothing is printed, very good. But what if I break the configuration? What if the config properties contains an invalid date? What would then happen? There are few things uglier than showing a stack trace in your HTTP response. But not only is it ugly, it's dangerous. You just told your client that you are using GDK on a specific version. So imagine the following scenario. A maleficent user would take these line numbers from here and infer the versions of the libraries that you're using. You might actually figure out that this is a certain version of the Spring web jar. Why? Because only on some version, there is this line number for this particular method. So an attacker might actually determine the versions of your libraries and then exploit their known weaknesses and attack you. So this is a security issue if you display them, if you slip stack traces to your clients over HTTP. This is very bad. And the first thing I want to do here is to make sure this never happens. Let's actually start building our little global exception handler. This is what we will focus on building in the following. Let me just find my package. Here it is. I want to create a new global exception handler. Now, this is a REST controller advice. And since I'm a big fan of Lombok, there you go. And God give me a log. Thank you. Now, in this, I will define an exception handler. This exception handler is supposed to be dispatched any kind of exception which slips from which gets out of any control only from any REST controller method. So any kind of, I don't know, get mapping, request mapping that slips an exception, that exception will end up being dispatched to me here, such that I can provide the HTTP response for that exception. I will put here a response status, which by default returns a 500 to my user. Very good. And then let's start with the simplest thing. The first thing I want to do is to log an error saying that unexpected printing error, maybe putting the E, which will unroll the stack trace. And I will call it unexpected. Very good. After which I will return E got get message, because that's one thing I could imagine using, sending to my clients when, let me just see if I can start. Sending the message of my exception to my client is a very, I don't know, the first idea I get, right? But at least let's not see the stack trace anymore. Okay, let's see. If I refresh, okay, this is better. It's still telling that you're using Java, but yeah, it's better than those line numbers that we just had. So that's the first temptation, to use the message of the exception and to display that to your user. And this might actually work for small apps, for homeworks at faculty, for your little project. It's perfectly reasonable. But if you do this in large application, you'll have an issue at some point. The moment that you will try to assert that a certain exception really happened, you will end up checking error strings, checking message strings, right? And this is strange. I mean, what? Why would you do that? It becomes even more cumbersome when you start adding user input to those messages. You will end up with regex matching the exception error. I mean, what the heck, right? Fragile, brittle, hard to read tests. Now, from another perspective, a colleague of yours might say that, wait a second, you aren't really following the separation of concerns because you are mixing presentation, I mean, the error message, with detecting the business condition in which a certain exception should occur. So the moment that you start adding messages to your exceptions, you are kind of violating MVC in a way. That's why exception messages are not the best idea here. Instead, you might think of using an integer. But integers are famously not very developer-friendly. You would need the exception manual close by whenever you want to interpret a certain error, which is very, very, very bad, very evil. But fortunately, Java has a very good alternative every time you have a finite set of values. Of course, enums. And that's what we will focus on in the following. We will build our own exception. Let's start doing that. My exception. This exception will, of course, extend from runtime exception. Good. And we'll have inside an enum named error code. I will define in this error code a general error. Interesting. And then also a bad config error code. Interesting again. Now, this error code is an enum. I should have a field in my exception, which is called error code, of course. And I will take a step further and make a private object array named the private final, of course. Everything should be final. And then saying it params, for example. Let's create the constructor. Actually, when creating the constructor, I need to be careful because I want to have the inherited constructors from above also. And God give me getters. Getters you have. Very good. One little trick I want to do just for fun, I will replace object array parameters with object three dots. By the way, my shortcuts that I'm pressing are always displayed in the top corner here. So when you replay this session, check that part. Now, what would I do with this exception? Well, you see, whenever I want to have a specific error message, I would throw this exception having this particular error code. Let's try to do that. Imagine in my configuration, instead of throwing a runtime exception, I want now to throw a new my exception. Now, I would provide the code bad config, thank you. And then always, I mean, maybe some parameters, but more important than the parameters, I should always take care to hook the original cause, the original exception as the cause of my new exception. In other words, do not decapitate your exceptions. Do not decapitate your exceptions like that. Hook the original one there. Cool. And if I do that, then this exception will propagate with this error code inside. This error code, I will go ahead and I will translate in a property file. Ooh. In English, it says invalid app config. Okay. Whereas in Romanian, that would be like bad config, evarză config. There you go. Let's see what happens. What pieces do I still need? I need in my global exception handler to declare that I need to handle differently my exception. In other words, if an instance of my exception slips from a REST controller, then I want to handle it a bit different. How? Well, first thing, I would like to read the properties file. I mean, to translate that error code. How would I do that? I would need from Spring, private final, message source. There you go. Message source. Automatically injected via the invisible constructor around here by Lombok. And this message source offers me a very convenient get message, which I can use to get code name, get the name of the enum, get the params from the exception, and then come the locale. Where could I get the locale in which I should translate? Well, I could request from Spring, HTTP server request. By the way, I'm talking about Spring, but this is perfectly applicable to any other web frameworks out there. I mean, everything. JaxxRS, Micronaut, Quarkus, everything works the same way. But they have different annotations, but you can get to the same stuff. From the request, you can get the get locale, and this will get you the locale of the HTTP request. And this is the user message, which I need then to send back to my user right here. And I think it's a good practice to hook it here also. Since we're here, I will also translate here, looking for the general error code. No arguments for you, and the same request from here. In other words, even the general error has a different representation in English and in Romanian. Okay, good. Let's see. Am I done? User message, almost. Let's see if this works. Oh my God, would that work? Let's see. Restart. Let's see, am I lucky? Let's see. Let's go here, and now, because the date is indeed invalid, when I refresh, I want to see the translated message in, let's see what language, in from Spring Boot. And we get an invalid app config, perfect. But what if I swap my language, what if I change my language from English to my native one? So move to the top, refresh here, and guess what? Romanian, yeah, perfect. Switching back to English, so basically what I just did in my global exception handler, I took the accept language header from the request sent by the browser and used that to translate my message in the language of the browser. Very simple. Nice, this is quite powerful, but it can get even better than that. What's with the parameters? I didn't tell you anything about that. Well, let's imagine that there would be some user input here. It's not really the case. I'm pushing things a bit here. But imagine that this file might be the user input for some reason. I don't know. Then you are free to add parameters. How would you use these parameters? These parameters you can then use in your message properties here, like that, and allow your a fixed string there to be templatized. Very easy, very, very easy. And there you go. If I refresh here with a bit of luck, I should see. There you go, the name of the file which I was looking for. So you see, you are able to templatize these error messages, this internationalized error message. You are now able to really fill the holes in there by using these parameters that I've showed you. Very nice. But here comes an interesting question. I mean, okay, very interesting from a technical point of view, but really, could the user do anything about that? I mean, what could the user do? Could he set a hash to the server and fix the config? I mean, what the heck? What do you expect the user to do? In this particular example, user can't really do anything useful, right? So instead of having a dedicated error message, I would definitely prefer instead to throw it a general error like that. And since we're here, I could even go more than that and create a new constructor, which just delegates to the canonical one, let's say, with a, let's see if I get it right, general. Am I lucky? Yes, that's it. Overload this constructor for convenience, which just wraps the exception in a different one. Very nice. Okay, and what would this end up? Let's see, let's redeploy. Suddenly we are throwing an exception with the general error code. Let's see here. So I would expect to see a different message when I refresh. Just a bit of patience. Let's refresh. There you go. Internal error. So you see, that's the general error code that we are using now. Interesting. But even more interesting, I would like to introduce for you a best practice regarding exception, which sounds like this. If you ever find yourself breakpointing or looking at logs to understand why an exception occurred, you might instead add more, throw an exception in such a way that you can include the interesting debugging information. Let me show you the example. You'll get the point. Could not read config from and put the file, which is quite a good idea, absolute path. Now, of course, I will need another constructor for here because this is the message and this is the calls, and I will need to delegate to what to the message, of course, and in general. And maybe the cause was the first one. Let's see if I get it right. Am I lucky? Yes, I am. So this will create a general exception, but also putting a custom exception message. Why is that important? Because if you find yourself debugging the exception, it will be very convenient for you to clearly see in the stack trace, in the very stack trace, where was the log file loaded from. So for your fellow developers, this is very, very useful in the exception. But again, you see, I'm not showing this to my user. It's just the custom exception message that I'm using. Nice stuff, good stuff, lots of stuff. And let's recap a bit what we just saw in this section. Well, we translated exceptions. We did that by introducing our own custom runtime exception, which has inside an error code. Now, for each such enum value, there is a corresponding translation in a message properties, of course, with corresponding translations for every supported language, right? And then, each enum corresponds to an entry in the message properties. Now, there is a debate here. In many teams that I've trained, there was this, some teams chose to translate the error codes on the front-end side. However, my preference, clearly, is to translate them on the back-end side for two reasons. First of all, whenever I add one more error code, I do not need to touch any files from front-end. The only change I do, I add one more line here, here, and here, and here, and I'm done. Right? I don't need to touch stuff outside. And then I will send translated messages to my front-end, just like I do right now. I have yet another benefit, another trick I could use. I could actually write a unit test that would verify that for each such enum, there is a corresponding entry in all the properties files out there. Interesting, to make sure I don't miss one code. So it's interesting, right? Then we saw how we can templatize, how we can parameterize those messages, right? To send the offending user input back to the user interface. So the thing that the user sent to us, which was not correct, we should send back to him to show what was wrong. Right. Another general, we discussed about this. In case the user really can't do anything about that exception, we should not be showing them more details than necessary. Now, don't get me wrong. It's a good practice, it's a good habit to put yourself in the shoes of your users. But in this case, it's a trap. Do not consider, don't show more than strictly necessary for them, right? That's why most of your exceptions, you will just use general, because they can't really do anything. Clearly, in our case, they can't really fix the missing configuration. Now, coming back to this principle of not having anything but runtime exceptions to the core of your logic, this assumes that there is a global exception handler that catches any exceptions that slips out. Very well. And we've done that. We wrote a global exception handler with Spring that does that. Interesting. But you see, if you really do that, you will find yourself with very few cases in which you need to catch. You would actually need to catch only those recoverable exceptions, but trust me, there won't be any. I mean, one every 100 exception, yeah, that one, you might somehow recover it, try, I don't know, work around. But this is not normally the case. For those recoverable exceptions only, you might end up having catches, right, in the core of your application. Interesting. But you see, to be able to catch only that particular exception, that's really a valid reason that you should create a subtype of your exception. To sketch what I mean here, I would create yet another exception, like recoverable never happens exception, which will actually can extend further from my exception. And you can fill the gaps in the following. You get the point where I'm going. But then somewhere in the code, I should have a catch. If you don't have a selective catch on this type, then you're doing it wrong. I mentioned this because I saw teams that they distinguish between exceptions by creating hundreds of exception types. This is bad. The way to distinguish between exceptions just to display them to your users is not by creating hundreds of classes, but by using that enum. That's why I introduced this. Hope you get the point. Again, if something is not clear, I have 5 blog entries, quite lengthy, that you can deep dive into. But let aside this weird, very, I mean, this almost never happens. However, more frequently, it happens that you find yourself debugging exceptions. Like looking at logs and breakpointing around, like, whoa, what the hell are you doing? If you do that, you would typically be hunting for some interesting variable that you want to inspect. And when you find yourself doing that, I just showed you a technique you could use to avoid doing this. In other words, if you jump back to code, what I just did in my config, I added a message, an exception message, which added the necessary debugging information that I wanted to see in here. So this key variable added in the exception message of the read-thrown exception. And this we name it the catch read-throw with debug. Why is it so interesting? Because it will allow you to see everything. So when the stack trace unrolls at the end, you will see all the interesting information that you ever need to have. Oh, and one final reminder, don't ever forget to put the root cause in here. Don't decapitate your exceptions. Don't do that. Catch and then throw another one. In every training group I had, there is at least one developer who, at some point in their career, hunted for such cases in libraries. Libraries which hid the original exception and rethrown a different one. And you had to go breakpoint and do all sorts of miseries. So do not decapitate your exceptions. This is a warning here. Cool. So let's put it in a different perspective. Let's state out all the main reasons you have to catch read-throw in Java. First of all, you might want to catch and read-throw an exception in order to provide a user-friendly message by means of an enum code, or then to unit test that particular error condition happened. Okay, very nice. By means of an enum code. You could also be catching throwing to add more debugging information for your fellow brother in arms, for your fellow developers, like I did here. Interesting. Okay, and then you are still left with one interesting case. The case in which you really don't want to say anything else, but just getting rid of the checked exception. This happens. It happens quite often. There is a checked exception that you do not want to unit test, that you do not want to present nicely to your user. And honestly, if you leave the code just like that, the behavior is pretty much similar, except that you don't have this nice log in here. So the same internal error, please check the logs, is shown to the user, right? Because this is the default behavior for any runtime exception. So you see, if you are facing such repeated snippets of code. I have one more trick to show you, but some of you will not agree. I will comment everything. Everything. And then, no more try, no more catch, nothing. And you will say, what are you doing? This will throw exception. Not quite. And even IntelliJ, my God, has this suggestion, add snippet truth. What in the world is that? And how come? Where is my catch? Where is my throw? Where is my throw? There's nothing like that. Now, when I first saw that, all right, what is Lombok? Lombok is an annotation processor which is able to tweak your bytecode as it's being compiled by Java compiler. So to get what it does, what it did, we need to look in the bytecode. And when you open the bytecode, which was written on disk, we find this. I will leave you just several moments to check this. I have a catch, throwable, throwable, and no throws. 3, 2, 1. How the heck this compiles? Let's try to put this here. Copy-pasting from the bytecode, from the decompiled bytecode, you find that this code does not compile. How in the world can uncompilable code have ended up in my class file? That's a good question. The lengthy answer is on my blog post, but the main point here is that to see how this really can work at runtime, you have to know that the distinction between checked exception and runtime exception is only enforced by the Java compiler. The Java runtime doesn't care about, doesn't make any distinction. So basically what Lombok did, just bypassed those checks in the compiler and threw the throwable, threw the checked exception under the hood, despite the compiler, if I can say that. This is a bit creepy because, you know, if you end up throwing that IO exception, what if you want to catch it? Just imagine, I want to catch that IO exception. And this is a panic moment. The compiler won't agree with you. My friend, this doesn't throw anything. You see? So you are in a very weird case, in a very weird situation. However, just let me state this for you. You should use sneaky throws whenever you don't ever plan to catch that exception again. That exception will propagate down to the global exception handler in here. And it will enter this handler. And it will be converted to my users as a general error. And this is mind-blowing, my friends. Let's see how this works. And this does work. I can understand in case you are not very happy with what I'm showing you now. And I can understand if you would ban this from your team. But I also know of cases in which projects were heavily using an old library or some legacy code base, which kept throwing checked exceptions in their head. When they faced such ugly API, putting sneaky throws everywhere was such a relief. No more catches, and what the heck? Just magically, let the fatal errors propagate down to your global exception handler. So again, you are not supposed to be catching again those exceptions because you can't really catch those. More of that on my blog. Cool. I want to spend some time now to discuss about the queen, the boss, the chief, the big boss of all exceptions. Now, this is an emotional moment. Do you know what is the most frequent exception in Java? Of course you know, the null pointer exception. But do you folks know that there were songs written to praise this exception? Here's one song to null pointer exception. Never seen you looking so lovely as you did tonight. Never seen you shine so bright. Never seen so many men ask you if you wanted to dance. Looking for a little romance. Give out half a chance. I have never seen that dress you're wearing. All the highlights in your hair that catch your eye. I've been blind, lady in red.
dancing with me.
There are songs written to this exception, for this exception, the most frequent exception in Java. My friends, and in general, this was the ode to any kind of hard-to-trace exception. My friends, against null, we do not defend. Against null, we charge. There is nothing, we do not defend and wait for null to happen. Let's see how we can aggressively fight null out of our code. Remember the bugs we had in our configuration, in our base code? There was one bug occurring on this position because the offer date ended up being null. Now, according to what the business said at the phone, no order can ever have a null offer date. It's violating a business rule. So if this is the case, you should go here. I mean, you could go in here and take the offer date to the constructor to guarantee you are always given an offer date, and then do the if offer date. If this is null, then throw new illegal argument exception. This is the oldest way of checking for null. Let me just fix the problem. So nowadays, you can't possibly create an order unless you specify the offer date. Good. So this is the oldest way to check for nulls. Now, there is another way, of course, which is assert that offer date. I don't particularly like that so much because, as you know, you can disable assertions at runtime by a flag. Well, why would I want that? Okay. That's why, I mean, the most widespread technique I see nowadays in the teams that I train on is the following: require non-null from objects. It's a one-liner which does both the null check and returns you back the value. Now, it's weird to see a library code throwing null pointer exceptions intentionally. I mean, it's weird. People like are a bit mad about that. Why would you do that? But the point is that you are throwing the exception early. That's the whole point of it. You do not propagate an order with a bomb in it. You do not propagate an order with a null offer date in it, right? Cool. Now, require non-null is a third form and the most widespread. But there is one more technique I saw some teams are using and might be handy at some point. Again, from the magic realm of Lombok, there is non-null. Now, if you wonder what this would do, given that Lombok will hack your compiled bytecode, let me just check, then you would expect, right, to see in the bytecode an if and a throw. And there you go, in constructing the null pointer exception and throwing the null pointer exception. You would expect that Lombok added this null check to your code. But again, this might be a bit too much magic. I wouldn't use it here. I would use it maybe in some boundary methods which take data from outside. I don't know, not here. It's too easy to have it in one line like that. Oh, but we have one flaw. What if after constructing our order, they would hack it, set offer date null. The moment you have setters, right, you need to enforce the constraint in the setter also. So the set offer date here should do the same thing. So require non-null, twice control space to autocomplete static in IntelliJ, and you end up with this. At the moment which you notice duplication, my God, duplication, what should we do? Well, of course, make a method out of it. What the heck? So instead, I will actually here call my own setter, something that I don't normally like so much, but in this case, it's quite reasonable. Folks, we are building here, in case you noticed, a self-validatable data model. We are building here something which is resilient to stupidity, to mistakes. Not so test friendly. We still need to tweak a bit to be able to use Hibernate in here, but we are close to it. I'm going in the direction of a domain-driven self-validating model. You might not be able to do that immediately in your code base, but the benefit is that they will never ever have a null in here. Cool. So throwing early, at the moment you try to create something inconsistently, it's a good practice. Now, what do we remember the second null pointer exception we had? We had because the member card was null. And we defended ourselves with this null check. Now, this is a tricky thing. This is no longer an invalid case. This is perfectly reasonable for the customer not to have a member card. How would you do that? Well, to your surprise and maybe disagreement, I would do that. I will make my getter to return an optional. Now, in your mind, there should be a bunch of thoughts. What are you doing? Don't touch the holy getter. Take your hands off it. Let me first show you the benefit. No developer out there could ever mistakenly do get member card dot over the null. The moment you do that, you are giving a optional member card. So you are forced at compilation time to realize that there might be nothing in here. And you will be forced to take measures, right? To act on this. Right? And or else not zero. Or else zero. Let's first extract this as a variable because we've gone past the danger line here. So let's make a variable out of this, and I will call this, how we call it, points. Points. Are these points fidelity point or else zero? Yeah, perfectly reasonable. If there is no member card, then guess what? You have no points, no fidelity points. So you see, by compilation, you tell your clients, the developers using that getter, that there might be nothing in. Very powerful, but also a bit contrived. Now, what do I point out here is that you could use you could make your getters return optionals. Now, this means that in your holy entity model, the getters for every every nullable column in the data store could then return optional. You might now think about Hibernate. What? Oh my God! What would Hibernate say? Hibernate won't care because Hibernate reads from fields anyway. It doesn't care about your getter. Never. Call that. Oh, what about Jackson? You could tweak Jackson very easy to read directly from your fields effectively anyway. So that being said, one final warning here, do not add optional getters on stupid data models, like your data transfer objects, those JSON objects. These optional getters are meant for your entity model, for that data model that you write heavy, thousands, hundreds of lines of code. That's where the danger is, okay? And that's where you really get the benefit from your option. Because that's the real reason why a null pointer is the most frequent bug, because in large code bases, you don't really recall which can be null and which can't. With optional, you can make your model friendlier to this. Nice. Which is very good, very, very, very fun, because Java just gave us a huge tool to fight the most widespread bug in Java. And it took me, 10 minutes to show you the point? It will take you 2 years to apply this everywhere in your model, I know. But the good news is that throughout those years, you will find at least several dozens of places in which you, by mistake, just walked over a mine. Walked over a null pointer, exception in disguise. We found several dozen such cases when we refactored our optional getters, two optional getters. Cool. So Java 8 brought us a powerful tool, the optional, but it also brought us headaches. Why? Now, moving on a different part of the presentation. Java 8 standard functional interfaces don't declare to throw any checked exceptions. So every time you call checked functions or checked exception, you are in pain. Let me show you what I mean. Let's suppose we have these date strings and you want to parse them. Well, date strings, let's map them. And starting from a string, I will format.parse s. Very good. And then collect two lists. Pay attention to what I type. This is the least amount of keys I can ever type. Date. Good. And then this date, piece them out on the console. Very good. Now, the bad news is that this doesn't compile because, you see, this throws checked exception, and you aren't allowed to throw checked exception from functions. Let's isolate the problem a bit. You see, this thing is a function. Let's extract it. That's the function that you want to pass to your map. function. But the bad news is that function doesn't declare to throw anything here. And because of that, it just isn't compiled with this function, which declares to throw checked exception. If there were an interface function throwing, which could really throw exception, then you could assign this to it. Just take a moment and look at it. Function throwing is compiling, is okay. There is no compilation error on this line. You can assign this to such a function. The bad news is that what map expects is a plain function from Java 8. So how can we transform from FF to F? That's the question. So let's transform FF to F. Now, my friends, you will now see one of the most horrible method signatures you ever saw for the past 2 weeks, or 1 month probably, or this year. This function takes a function and returns back another function. It's the worst kind of a higher order function. Let's start the old style. I'm returning a new function which, when called, it will call the function which I give it as a parameter, apply that function to the arguments. But the problem is that this function declares to throw. So of course, I need to do a try catch here and wrap the checked exception into a runtime one. Nice. Now, with the help of IntelliJ, there's your lambda. Nice idea, really. It's very interesting to have such a utility, right? You can magically convert. And look how good the code could look. Just let me inline all the variables and use all the hints for IntelliJ. Look how nice this really looks. I mean, it's amazing. It's quite a brilliant idea, right? And as any brilliant idea out there, someone else had it 8 years ago. There's unchecked, the Joule library for you, which does exactly the same thing. So don't start doing that yourself. Use that. It's a very lightweight library. I would advise you to add to your code base in case you've been using Java 8 functional programming for several years already. Nice. Wow, my God. Calling a function with another function, getting back another. Nice. But now for the final mind blow, let's say, let me tweak a bit the requirements. Parse and print all dates if at least half are valid. What's that? Now, your head will explode. It's supposed to explode at the end of the presentation. I'm supposed to break your head. So let's start again. Date strings, thank you, dot map. And I would like to start again. Given a string, I will use format and call parse on that string. And then at the end, collect to list. Now, let's put some spaces in here. You see, this piece of code is throwing me checked exception. Now, pay attention to what I'll be writing. It's all recorded, so watch it again later on. Try from Vavr, another library for you, of. Try of takes a supplier, takes a function. Now again, folks, don't be scared. This is a function. Do you agree? It's actually a supplier, but a supplier which throws checked exception. Good. So you are giving this supplier to try of, and then try of will return you back, surprise, surprise, a stream of tries. What are you talking about? What's that? Tries. Now, a try, those of you more familiar with functional programming, are aware of this concept. The other of you are completely lost now. Now, how would you get the successful parse date from this? From the tries, you should filter first and only leave the success, and then map and get the value out and collect to list. And these are the successor, the dates that you really could parse. Interesting. What's the requirement? You should be printing these, so dates S out, only if, so this should be in an if. Let's see if I can do it. Thank you. An if, which tests the success ratio. Let's see if I can compute this in one shot. Now, the most geek way I could find to compute this is the following. Tries map to double. In case the try is successful, now your head will explode, I promise. then one, otherwise zero, and then average. Think about this again, and this is the success ratio of, I mean, how many of this? Of course, I forgot to do or else zero. If I can change the variable type, thank you. Success ratio is used here. And in case the success ratio is greater or equal to 0.5, done. You print it. Else, and I will test it in a moment. Else, as error, oops. Let's run this. Now, notice that there is one corrupted date in here. This will not be printed, right? But still, there are two correctly parsed. So the two that are correctly parsed from October and December are here. The November is not there. But if I mess up this also, then there will be two of them incorrect. The majority will be incorrect. And this if will go the other way. Oops. There you go. Now, for the conclusions, because I know this was mind-blowing. First, for the last part, we just saw how we could use the Joule library to pass a function throwing checked exception. And this little utility will convert it into a function from Java standard, which doesn't throw any checked exceptions. Nice, cool. The next moment of pain was when I introduced try. Now, a try is really an either, for those of you more familiar with functional programming, an either which can hold either the result of a computation or an exception that occurred during that computation. Interesting. And using try would allow you to collect both results and exceptions in a single pass to your data. That's the power of it. For the final conclusions, and again, there are more deep stuff going on the blog. Use runtime exceptions everywhere. Do not use checked exceptions in the core of your business logic in normal custom developed applications. In case a checked exceptions annoy you in many places, consider sneaky throws after you brainstorm this and you agree this in your team. In case the checked exceptions occur in a Lambda, just use Joule to get rid of it, like I showed you. We saw the diaper anti-pattern, which is called catching exception and just swallowing. Don't decapitate your exceptions. Hook up the original exception calls. Don't log and then rethrow. Instead, trust that there is a global exception handler, and there is more to say about that. We only implemented them, such a handler, for REST endpoints. There are other threads going on in your system, like schedulers, asynchronous, GMS messages, all sorts of stuff. Take caution to correctly report errors occurring in those threads also, but it's out of scope for this. Use an enum for error codes in case you want to display those errors to your users or to assert them from your tests. Consider catching an exception and rethrowing it wrapped in another exception with a message which contains the useful debugging information such that you can just look at the stack trace and have all the debugging pieces in it. Defeating the null pointer exception, there are two main techniques. Either you build a self-validating data model, painful, overkill for most projects, or even easier actually, to switch to optional getters, progressively, slowly, finding null pointer exceptions along the way. And for the last thing, that was quite mind-blowing because it was a shift in paradigm. We no longer break the execution flow. Instead, we treat exceptions like normal return values. Mind-blowing. And there are other languages out there like Golang, which do this by default with exceptions. Now, that being said, in case you are interested in those blog entries, in case you want a company, in case you want to join yourself a masterclass, in case you want my best talks, there's my website here, there's my training curricula. And what can I wish you? Have a nice exception. There are many questions in the chat, or in the I heard you ask a lot of exception, a lot of questions. So if you can maybe.
Okay, so the first question is, can you talk about the cost and performance implication of stack traces?
Yes. When I first heard of this problem, I learned that they are costly. However, they were dramatically improved in late. I actually built a little benchmark of my own. Performance GMH. That's it. Check this out. This there is one particular benchmark in here, which plays a bit of that. But it's very difficult to give you, what is it? Throw the exceptions test. It's very difficult to really point to, there are several nanoseconds, but compared to what? If you are planning of using exceptions or your main flow as a sort of a go-to to short-circuit the execution of your program, then you are on the wrong track. You should not be throwing hundreds, thousands of exceptions per second. That's bad. However, until you really print out the stack trace, the cost is not that high as it used to be in the previous version, prior to Java 7 or 8. So stack traces are painful, as you say, when you unroll them. I hope I answered. If not,
that was a great answer. Thank you. Back at the beginning of the presentation, you used my bad config exception. Why did you choose to use it rather than an enum?
Because in, yeah, good question. And I actually mentioned exactly this technique at some point. When I mentioned that the only reason that you should really consider creating new exception types is when you selectively catch them. Why? Because in normal application, we'll have hundreds of error clauses. I don't want you to create 200 exception types. It's insane. It doesn't scale. Right?
That's okay. Great. Our next question is, if you're working on a swing or desktop application, what pattern would you use instead of a global exception handler?
Nice one. Very nice one. As you know, on a thread, let me see if I can get it right. On a thread, you can set default uncaught exception, blah, blah, that thing. Now, there are, in swing or desktop apps, there is a distinction about the main thread or the UI thread and the other background threads. If you are on the UI thread, be very careful with your exceptions. Very careful. Consider using some swing utilities to work around it. If you are concerned of exceptions happening in background threads, because it's a typical best practice to do all the heavyweight or the heavy work on a background thread, not blocking the UI thread. On the background thread, be very cautious. Oh, to point you to the right direction, executors, let me see if I can get it right. Let's see, new thread pull task executor, and here, wait a second, executors, well, is it not new thread pull? This is from Spring, the other one. This one has this. This thread factory allows you to slip in a way that you can create threads such that you can add the thing that I just said to you, this one. You can set uncaught exception handler on your thread pools. It's very powerful, especially if you are in the habit of creating your own thread pools. Spring handles it gracefully, but if you create them yourself, it's a very good idea to use that. Hope I answered.
We had a question about the presentation itself. What software are you using to draw on the screen?
Yes, the bad news is that it's only on Windows. It's called Zoomit. It's actually one of the most frequent questions I got.
You're like an advertisement for this product.
No, it's free. No. Free. Done by a super brilliant guy from, but it's not no longer maintained.
Cool.
But very good tool indeed.
Back to exceptions. What would you say to developers that use a try-catch block and don't deal with the error?
I didn't plan on showing you this, but since you asked, I actually have another name for this. It was out of my slide here. Let me dive in to see the point. Here, I would consider when I discuss exception handling in this regard. I mean, just catching and doing nothing. And I teach this to young developers, I would name it shawarma style for two reasons. Why? First, because when you're eating a shawarma, you might be swallowing things that you do not expect. Secondly, because that becomes a possible career path if you are in a habit of doing this every day. So think three times if you do this. At least put a log trace in here, please. Okay.
And then our next question.
Yes.
Our next question is, do you think checks exceptions will ever be removed from Java?
No. Java is has a lot of legacy, huge, the biggest legacy today on Earth. It can't, they just can't be removed.
Yep.
And plus, there are still some libraries out there that really make use of it in real case. I mean, not the scope of this presentation today, but no, I don't think they'll.
Okay.
Not soon, anyway.
And our last question, with respect to testing and exceptions, what happens if you add a dependency such as Lombok and it changes the behavior?
Well, you are, yeah, that's a problem. The good news is that 80% of the teams, and I've talked to more than 100 teams, 80% of those teams that I train and discuss with, they are all using Lombok for many years already. Let me twist the exception, the question back. What would you do in case Spring changed its behavior? So Lombok is, I would say that it's even more widely used than Spring today.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they won't change because it's so, I hope. You won't upgrade, but what the heck. And it's not that of a big library. You can fork it, and the community will fork it.
Mm-hmm.
If this ever happens.
Okay, and that comes to the end of the questions. Thank you, Victor. And for everyone watching, we'll be resuming in just under 2 hours with Kay Hortzman on Project Loom and concurrency. Thanks all.
Thanks. Bye.